Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Birdpedia, a brief compendium of avian lore, by Christopher W. Leahy, narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Preface. Almost four decades ago, I published an encyclopedic handbook of North American bird life titled The Birdwatcher's Companion. At 917 pages, it fit comfortably under the definition of a tome. In 2002, Princeton University Press brought out a thoroughly revised and updated second edition that was even heftier, with a page count well over 1,000. My dual, and perhaps somewhat dueling, objectives for the companion were: 1. That it be comprehensive, encompassing a full gamut of ornithological knowledge, from what crepuscular means and who Alexander Wilson was, to how many species of woodpeckers there are in the world and how to cook a scoter; and 2. That this potentially daunting accumulation of bird lore, while striving for meticulous accuracy, could also be written in an accessible style that could be read for pleasure as well as information, even for fun. Aside from a disparity in pure tonnage, the main difference between the companion and the present modest volume is that the Birdpedia, while still composed of entries in alphabetical order, makes no claim to be encyclopedic. It might be described as a teaser, perhaps, aiming ideally for the kind of curious listener who has noticed that a large and growing percentage of the world's population has become fascinated, in some cases obsessed, with birdwatching, or to use the sportier term, birding. If people now spend billions of dollars annually on optical equipment, identification guides, bird feeding paraphernalia, and guided tours to Mongolia in search of exotic species, it might be worth looking into a little book to find out why so many otherwise sane people are staring into the trees or scanning smelly mud flats these days. In the Birdpedia, you will find no exhaustive accounts of bird taxonomy or the avian digestive system, or even descriptions of bird families. But there are general essays on bird watching and identification that attempt to give the uninitiated a sense of what the fuss is all about. Summaries of some of the more fascinating aspects of bird life, such as migration, brood parasitism, and vocal mimicry, as well as briefer, more whimsical entries calculated to provoke a smile or stretch credulity. The listener will still find a definition of crepuscular, not to mention goat sucker, still discover the identity of Alexander Wilson, not to mention Eleonora of Arborea, and still have access to scoter recipes. But the geographic coverage has been expanded beyond North America, and there is substantive material that did not appear in the companion, such as Shakespeare's birds and birding while black. There are birds everywhere, swimming below the ice in Antarctica, nesting by the millions on Arctic tundra, dancing in the trees in the rainforests of Papua New Guinea, gathering at oases in the Gobi Desert, soaring over the highest peaks of the Andes and migrating above Mount Everest, chasing fish more than 1,750 feet down in the ocean depths, sharing a meal with a pride of lions, nesting on skyscrapers in New York City, and their distribution is by no means limited to geography. Birds are abundant in our art, in our poetry, in our music, in our myths and movies and medicine, in our food and fashions and fantasies. And in the fossil record, millions of years before there were any human bones to ponder. It is this astonishing avian diversity of form, of behavior, of interaction with our own species that the Birdpedia means to deploy to turn a nagging curiosity into a compelling fascination and perhaps a new, more intimate relationship with the natural world. It can be said that a love of birds manifests itself in three fundamental ways. 1. As pure pleasure, the first Baltimore Oriole of the spring, the cry of a curlew over the marsh. 2. As an ever-widening curiosity that leads to newfound knowledge, perhaps even to wisdom. And 3. As a concern for the fate of the world's bird life, now gravely threatened by human recklessness, and a willingness to take action, however modest, to conserve it. My fondest hope for this modest volume of bird lore is that it might provide inspiration for all three. Abundance. How many birds? It should surprise no one that the question of how many individual birds are alive on this planet at any given moment has yet to be answered with any degree of certainty. True, there are a few highly conspicuous species, for example, whooping crane, whose breeding and wintering distributions have been fully discovered, and whose total populations are so small that we know precisely how many individuals presently exist. But even estimates for scarce and well-studied species may have large error factors, either because it is difficult to distinguish individuals in populations of wide-ranging species, such as raptors, or because population numbers are extrapolated based on counts of single males, for example, most rare songbirds. The breeding populations of certain seabirds, for example, Lysan albatross, great shearwater, northern gannet, and roseate tern, that nest locally in compact colonies, most of which are known, can be estimated with a high degree of accuracy simply by counting nest sites, though these counts do not include pre-breeding or vacationing birds. But when we consider even so limited a goal as calculating the number of black-capped chickadees in Massachusetts during a given month, not to mention the number of songbirds in India or the planet's total avian population, we begin to appreciate the difficulty of the task. To begin with, simply counting accurately the number of small woodland birds in a 10-acre plot involves much patience and labor and leaves the counter with little confidence that absolute accuracy has been achieved. Once there are reasonably reliable counts for a range of species and habitats, one can begin to make some tentative extrapolations, but consider some of the variables involved. The populations of all birds fluctuate greatly in the course of the year, hitting a low before birds of the year have hatched, when only individuals that have survived the ravages of age, winter, and predation exist, and peaking at the end of the breeding season, when in most cases juvenile birds outnumber adults by at least several fold. Even small-scale censuses show that some habitats support many more birds than others do, from as few as 13 birds, adults of all species, per 10 acres of woods or farmland, to more than 1,000 individuals in the same amount of exceptionally rich habitat, such as some tropical forests and wetlands. Bird populations in a given locality change drastically during the year, not only due to seasonal fluctuations affected by reproduction, but also due to bird movements. Areas of Arctic tundra that teem with breeding shorebirds and other birds are nearly or totally barren of bird life for six or more months of the year. And the already rich resident avifauna of Central America is increased no one knows how many times by the flood of North American migrants that arrive on their wintering grounds there each fall. Population densities of different species vary greatly, making it impossible to extrapolate total bird populations from what is known about one or a few species. Bird populations increase and decrease in cycles and according to ecological variations. Northern finches and raptors experience alternating booms and busts, continually shifting patterns brought about by fluctuations in the amount of food available to the potential consumers. Some guesstimates. Despite the inherent difficulty in counting birds, the question of how many exerts a powerful fascination, partly, no doubt, because there are obviously so many, and partly because it would be very useful in judging the health of a given species, as well as of the whole environment, to know whether bird populations are declining drastically, now, alas, well documented for North America, holding their own, or even, certainly true in some cases, increasing. The following figures are taken from reliable sources, but are wisely hedged in some cases. The world's total avian population has been reckoned, by broad extrapolation, at around 100 billion, give or take some hundreds of millions. The total population of wild land birds in the contiguous United States at the beginning of the breeding season has been estimated at 5 to 6 billion birds, jumping to perhaps 20 billion with the addition of the young birds hatched in that breeding season. In a notably careful survey running the length of Finland and considering all habitats, the ornithologist Einari Merikallio came up with a total of 64 million adult breeding birds, with the two commonest species, chaffinch and willow warbler, making up 10% of the whole. There are about 44 North American species of birds, scarce, local, and/or conspicuous, colonial seabirds, whose total populations are accurately known. The red-billed quelea, a tiny African waxbill finch, family Estrelidae, may be the most abundant wild native bird species in the world. It occurs in locust-like swarms in the dry savannas south of the Sahara, where it wreaks havoc on grain crops. Single invasions of a particular region have been estimated to be 100 million birds strong, and the total population has been estimated at about 10 billion. The European starling and the house sparrow have been nominated as the world's most abundant land birds by some authorities, but others point out that while their distribution is wide, their occurrence is relatively localized. Estimates of the world's total domestic chicken population range from around 19 billion to more than 50 billion as of 2020, as compared with the total current human population of 7.8 billion. The most abundant species of wild North American bird known was the now-extinct passenger pigeon. About 3 billion are thought to have been alive at the time of Columbus. Based on its extremely broad distribution, local population densities, and vast wintering roosts containing millions of birds, the red-winged blackbird has been judged the most numerous of living native North American land birds. The red-eyed vireo may be the most abundant of eastern North American deciduous woodland birds. Of course, any one of many land bird species with high population density and broad distribution can enter this contest without fear of being too badly defeated. Air conditioning. Do birds sweat? Birds do not perspire by means of sweat glands in the skin as humans do, so they must avoid overheating by other means. To some degree, their air conditioning system is simply the reverse of their heating system. Instead of fluffing feathers to increase insulation, for example, they compress their plumage to retain as little body heat as possible. Or they can increase circulation to unfeathered parts to give off more heat rather than reduce circulation to retain it. Many temperate zone species molt into a thinner plumage for the summer or achieve one gradually by normal feather loss and/or wear. Birds also adapt their behavior to the air temperature, often seeking rest and shade during the hottest part of the day. Though they cannot perspire, birds do vaporize water in the lungs and internal air sacs and release it by panting. This explains why you can often see many types of birds holding their bills open on hot days. Another cooling device is known in ornithological jargon as guller flutter. The bare skin of the throat is quivered rapidly while the blood flow to the region is increased, thus letting off internal heat. This practice is especially prominent in birds with fleshy throat pouches, for example, cormorants, frigate birds, pelicans, and boobies. A good place to witness either or both of these phenomena is at a seabird colony at midday, when parent birds must sit on their nests and endure the full force of the sun while protecting their eggs or young from it. By human standards, practicality has always characterized the species of American vultures far better than fastidiousness. Their method of cooling off is consistent with their reputation. They defecate on their feet. Species of storks, now known to be closely related to the New World vultures, also practice this untidy method of evaporative cooling. Ali, Salim, 1896-1987. Creator of an environment for conservation in India, your work over 50 years in acquainting Indians with the natural riches of the subcontinent has been instrumental in the promotion of protection, the setting up of parks and reserves, and indeed, the awakening of conscience in all circles, from the government to the simplest village. Since the writing of your book, The Book of Indian Birds, your name has been the single one known throughout the length and breadth of your own country, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, as the father of conservation and the fount of knowledge on birds. From the tribute to Salim Ali on the presentation by the World Wildlife Fund of the second J. Paul Getty Wildlife Conservation Prize, February 19, 1976. This commendation is a fair description of the impact that Salim Ali had on conservation, education, and advocacy on behalf of birds in India and beyond. But it fails to capture the richness of his ornithological journey over 80 years. What follows aims to fill in just a few of the details. Salim Moizuddin Abdul Ali, the Birdman of India, was born into a well-to-do Muslim family in Bombay, the youngest of nine children. His earliest interest in birds was as targets for sport shooting with his air gun, until one W.S. Millard, secretary of the Bombay Natural History Society, noticed that one of his victims was an unusual species, a yellow-throated sparrow. This encounter is described in Ali's autobiography, The Fall of a Sparrow. This got the boy a tour of the society's collection of mounted birds, and by age 10, he had started to keep a journal on his bird observations. Ali's early academic career was spotty, barely qualifying for Bombay University in 1917, then dropping out to look out for some family business interests in Burma, tungsten mines and timber, which allowed him to nurture his natural history interest and shooting skills in the nearby forests. Returning to school, he briefly studied business law, but was persuaded by a perceptive professor to switch to zoology. He married in 1918, and his wife, Tamina, became a devoted companion in his future travels. They had no children, and he was devastated when she died in 1939 following a minor surgery. He never remarried. Passed over for an ornithologist position at the Zoological Society of India in 1928, Ali decided to continue his studies in Germany at the Berlin Natural History Museum, where he worked for the eminent ornithologist Erwin Stresemann, who, in Ali's words, became his guru and provided entry into the world of international ornithology, where he interacted with other prominent birdmen such as Ernst Mayr, S. Dillon Ripley, and Colonel Richard Meinertshagen. Ali was happiest when he was doing field studies and faunal surveys, which he pursued throughout India, and had little taste for the systematics and taxonomy that obsessed many ornithologists at the time. In 1956, he wrote to Ripley, "My head reels at all these nomenclatural metaphysics. I feel strongly like retiring from ornithology if this is the stuff, and spending the rest of my days in the peace of the wilderness with birds and away from the dust and frenzy of taxonomical warfare." He later said that he was dedicated to studying the living bird in its natural environment. For his part, Mayr complained to Ripley that Ali didn't collect enough birds to make the series of specimens necessary for taxonomic analysis. Contrarywise, Meinertshagen, who was accompanied by Ali on an expedition to Afghanistan in 1937, complained that he is quite useless at anything but collecting, and added this interesting cultural comment, which reflects as much on Meinertshagen as on Ali. Salim is the personification of the educated Indian. He is excellent at his own theoretical subjects, but has no practical ability. His views are astounding. He is prepared to turn the British out of India tomorrow and govern the country himself. Ali eventually found his way both as a scientific and popular writer about birds and as an effective and tireless advocate for conservation. He co-authored the authoritative 10-volume Birds of India and Pakistan with Dillon Ripley, as well as the immensely popular Book of Indian Birds and many other publications. He was instrumental in the establishment of the internationally significant wetland reserve in Rajasthan, alternately known as the Bharatpur Bird Sanctuary or Keola Deo National Park, and in preventing the destruction of what is now Silent Valley National Park in the Nilgiri Hills, Kerala. Having maintained his relationship since childhood with the Bombay Natural History Society, he was able to play a key role in supporting it when it fell on hard times in the 1940s by appealing to Prime Ministers Jawaharlal Nehru and Indira Gandhi, who was an avid birdwatcher. Space does not permit noting more than a sampling of all the honors that Salim Ali accrued by the end of his long career. He was the first non-British citizen to receive the Gold Medal of the British Ornithologists' Union and was also awarded the John C. Phillips Medal from the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources and was made commander of the Netherlands Order of the Golden Ark by Prince Bernhard, as well as receiving two of India's highest civilian honors and the Getty Prize referenced earlier. In addition, his name graces Salim Ali's swift, Apis salimalii, and several bird subspecies, as well as one of the world's rarest bats, Latidens salimalii. Altitude. We are impressed, as we should be, when we watch an eagle disappear from view thousands of feet above us, and when we hear of tiny songbird migrants routinely traveling in the night sky at 5,000 to 10,000 feet. Yet many small birds that live above the tree line on the world's highest mountains double or triple these altitudes as they flit from one lichen-covered rock to another. More impressive still are the record holders listed next. 37,100 feet, 11,300 meters, the highest documented bird flight. A Ruppel's griffin, a species of large vulture that collided with an airplane over the Ivory Coast, West Africa, on November 29, 1973. 33,000 feet, 10,000 meters. Common cranes migrating above the Himalayas. Approximately 29,000 feet, 8,800 meters. A flock of migrating bar-headed geese heard calling above the Himalayan peak Makalu, elevation 27,766 feet. 27,000 plus feet, 8,200 meters. A flock of whooper swans reported by a commercial airline pilot over the Outer Hebrides, Scotland, December 9, 1967. 26,000 feet. Alpine choughs, highest known altitude for a songbird recorded by the British expedition to Mount Everest in 1924. These members of the crow family followed the climber's camp as it ascended, probably scavenging leftovers, as is typical of this species, which habitually forages above the tree line. 21,000 feet. Highest recorded altitude for small land bird migrants detected by radar over Norfolk, England. No human being can engage in strenuous exercise above 20,000 feet without supplementary oxygen. But these avian high flyers have the ability to hyperventilate when circumstances demand it, increasing oxygenation of the blood and the availability of oxygen to the lungs. They apparently also have an altered structure in the protein hemoglobin that increases its already considerable affinity for oxygen. Anting. The application by birds of the body fluids of ants or other substances to their plumage. In passive anting, a bird squats on an ant nest and allows the insects to crawl over its plumage, sometimes while anting actively or at least going through the motions. In active anting, a bird crushes an ant in its bill and rubs it vigorously on parts of its plumage, particularly the underside of the wingtips and tail coverts, feathers that lie at the base of the tail both above and below. The ant fluid may be spread on the head and other parts from the wingtips, but certain parts of the body are treated only infrequently. More than 200 species of birds have been observed anting worldwide. It is practiced chiefly by songbirds. The purpose of anting is not fully understood, but some credible hypotheses have been offered based on critical observations. Ants that emit chemicals, especially formic acid, as a defense technique, are favored over ants whose main defense is stinging. It has also been demonstrated that formic acid kills feather mites. The consensus theory is that anting is an avian form of delousing. The activity is often followed by preening and bathing. In the absence of ants, birds will use mothballs, citrus roots, vinegar, still glowing embers, and other substances, most of which, like formic acid, produce a burning sensation. This kind of stimulation apparently releases the anting impulse, and since individual birds must discover the effect for themselves, some members of a species ant regularly, while others fail to learn the behavior. An alarming side effect of certain birds' fondness for a burning sensation is a propensity for picking up flaming tinder and transporting elsewhere, in some cases to nests constructed in buildings, sometimes with disastrous consequences. Apocalypse. We are presently witnessing a global extinction of species on an unprecedented scale and at an increasing rate. The causes, now abundantly documented, include the rapid and widespread destruction of the planet's tropical rainforests, which contain more than 50% of the world's living organisms, despite covering only 6% of the Earth's surface and other habitats, mainly due to agricultural conversion, pervasive contamination of our air and water with toxic chemicals, and the destructive effects of climate change, to name just three forms of environmental degradation caused directly by our species. Birds continue to play a heroic role as canaries in the global coal mine, demonstrating by their conspicuous decline the extent of our peril. For example, according to Birdlife International, 279 bird species and subspecies have gone extinct globally in the last 500 years, and as of 2018, 40% of the world's 11,000 bird species are in decline, and 1 in 8 species is threatened with extinction. Most alarming are recent comprehensive studies conclusively documenting the recent and continuing decimation of the majority of bird populations. According to research published in the journal Science in 2019, numbers of individual birds in Canada and the United States have fallen by 29% since 1970. That is, there are now nearly 3 billion fewer birds inhabiting North America than there were just 50 years ago. The decline affects many species, such as robins, jays, and blackbirds, normally considered abundant. And iconic species such as snowy owl and Atlantic puffin are officially deemed vulnerable and may be on a path to extinction. In retrospect, it hardly seems surprising that we are now in the throes of a bird apocalypse, considering the myriad means of extermination that we have practiced, as briefly summarized next. Overharvest. Unregulated killing for commercial markets as well as for sport, which went unchecked until the early 20th century, can be credited with the extinction of once abundant species such as the passenger pigeon and the great auk. It also drastically reduced the numbers of many shorebirds and waders and upland game birds before effective conservation laws were passed. Egrets were decimated by plume hunters between about 1875 and 1900. Habitat destruction. This has long been considered the single greatest threat to bird life on the planet, though chemical pollution is presently giving it a run for its money. It occurs in direct proportion to population growth and development, though it takes many forms. Draining and filling of wetlands for highway and mall construction, destroying natural grasslands for agriculture, clearing of forests for lumber and house lots. Habitat destruction continues to outstrip conservation. The clearing of tropical rainforest was estimated in 1989 to be continuing at the rate of about a football field per second. Since then, there have been fleeting hopes of increased protection, but under present 2020 anti-environmental, pro-business, and autocratic political leadership, the scope and rate of the forest destruction is greater than ever. Furthermore, we now know that the survival of tropical forests is crucial to such fundamental matters as the planet's oxygen supply, its climate, and its genetic diversity. Pesticides and other chemical poisons. The indiscriminate use of highly toxic chemicals to control insect pests stands as one of the chief follies of the modern era. Those who continue to urge heavy reliance on non-specific, highly toxic, persistent pesticides argue that they are the most effective and efficient means of controlling pest insects, such as mosquitoes, caterpillars, and leaf beetles. Opponents reply that such pesticides are insufficiently specific, killing good insects as well as bad, along with other insect-controlling organisms, such as birds and amphibians, and potentially destabilizing entire ecosystems, are highly persistent and mobile both in soil, whence they are washed into bodies of water, and in animal tissue, where they accumulate and increase in concentration as they are passed up a food chain. Pesticide residues have been detected in the tissue of humans living in the remotest reaches of the Earth. Exacerbate the problem, since their effect is short-term. Insect populations readily produce resistant generations, which in turn require the use of even deadlier pesticides or heavier applications of the original one, continue to be developed and promoted in ever more destructive forms, such as neonicotinoids, a family of pesticides that has proven to be highly destructive of the insect populations on which many birds depend. The recent documented decline of aerial and other insect populations has been described as an insect apocalypse that is implicated directly in the bird apocalypse. Lead poisoning is one of the oldest and most pervasive man-made threats to gallinaceous birds and waterfowl, which ingest, along with other grit, pellets from shotgun cartridges, the inevitable remains of the thousands of rounds of ammunition spent during hunting seasons. In addition, loons have been found to suffer high mortalities caused by the ingestion of lead fishing sinkers, and raptors are often killed by shot ingested when feeding on unretrieved game. The use of lead shot for hunting ducks, geese, and swans is now banned by federal law in the U.S., though, of course, tons of lead shot remain in wetland sediments. Oil spills. It does not require much imagination to understand that petroleum, seawater, and swimming birds do not mix well. Loons, grebes, tube noses, sea ducks, alcids, and other ocean-going species that are caught in the thick phlegm of an oil spill quickly become hopelessly mired, totally unable to function, and are thus doomed to a slow death by starvation, exposure, and poison. Even birds with apparently negligible oil stains may be dangerously liable to total loss of body heat, because the oil creates a gap in the insulation system that maintains a bird's body temperature on the cold ocean. Companion animals. The dogs, cats, rats, pigs, goats, and other animals that have followed the spread of Western civilization around the world pose serious threats to birds and other wildlife. Their arrival has been particularly devastating among endemic island species, such as the now-extinct Lison rail, which due to the absence of predators on its native island, had lost the ability to fly. However, any burrow-nesting or ground-nesting bird is potentially threatened by these animals. Cats are especially devastating to bird populations. It is estimated that there are presently about 60 million feral cats at large in the U.S., together with 60 to 88 million owned cats, a large percentage of which are allowed to run free. Cats have been responsible for the global extinction of 33 island-inhabiting species worldwide, and current science has confirmed that cats kill at least 1.3 to 4.0 billion birds a year in the lower 48 states. Man-made structures. Skyscrapers, power-generating windmills, and television towers represent hazards to low-flying migrants and other birds. Especially on foggy nights, the bright lights of city buildings may attract thousands of birds, which become disoriented, unable to find their way out of the maze of reflecting glass, and often die by flying into windows in their panic. Johnston and Haynes, 1957, record two particularly disastrous nights in early October 1954, during which more than 100,000 migrant birds were killed in only 25 localities sampled from New York to Georgia. A reasonable estimate of birds killed annually in North America by encounters with buildings, picture windows, and TV towers begins in the millions. Automobiles. In the 1960s, it was estimated that about 2.5 million birds were killed annually in collisions with automobiles in Britain. The number of birds killed on North America's much more extensive network of highways must be staggering. Invasive exotics. While introduced bird species such as European starlings and house sparrows have caused population declines in native cavity nesting birds through competition for nest sites, a more insidious threat is that from invasive plant species. A striking instance is that of native marsh bird communities, including species such as grebes, bitterns, and rails, many of which are becoming scarce due to wetland degradation caused in significant measure by invasive exotic plants such as common reed and purple loosestrife. Eradication of these plants once they are established has proven to be labor-intensive, expensive, and sometimes impossible. Threatening the whole. One reason so many people have recently become interested in the welfare of the world's wildlife is that our own fate is inextricably involved with that of our fellow organisms. These are a few of the many threats to the environment that we have posed quite recently. They are ones that relate particularly to bird life and in ways that have been clearly documented. Many others, such as air pollution, acid precipitation, disposal of chemical and nuclear wastes, and the release of greenhouse gases leading to global climate change, both alone and in combination, gnaw inexorably away at the abundance and diversity of earthly life. This self-inflicted corrosion afflicts not only our physical well-being, but also what we alone have the ability to appreciate, the overall quality of life. It was once traditional among coal miners to take a caged canary down into the shaft with them. When the canary fell off its perch, killed by lethal fumes, it was time to get out. If we wake up one morning to find birds falling off their perches, it will be too late to correct earlier miscalculations. And of course, there is nowhere else to go. Audubon, John James, circa 1785 to 1851. The name the world associates inextricably with birds belonged to an artistic genius who, like many of his kind, was as eccentric as he was brilliant. He was born at L'Ecaille Saint-Dominique, now Haiti, the acknowledged bastard of a well-to-do French merchant slaver, Jean Audubon. The artist once described the mother he never knew as being a lady of Spanish extraction, as beautiful as she was wealthy. But this appears to be an example of the autobiographical imagination that encouraged him to let it be rumored that he might be the lost Dauphin of France. His mother seems to have been Jeanne Rabin, a French chambermaid on his father's Caribbean estate, since Audubon was originally called Jean Rabin. But his father soon adopted him, along with a daughter also born out of wedlock, removed him to his French estate, and rechristened him Jean-Jacques Audubon. Having escaped from slave riots and revolution in his birthplace at age 3, Audubon arrived in France in the midst of the Reign of Terror, and when he was 17, his father sent him to his farm outside of Philadelphia to avoid Napoleon's draft. By this time, Audubon had acquired the education and graces of a well-to-do French citizen, including competence in riding, fencing, playing the violin, and drawing. His father also encouraged his interest in natural history, especially birds. Like many another genius, Audubon was a failure at workaday occupations such as family and business. Even his early labors as an itinerant portraitist amounted to little, except probably to hone his drafting skills. He lost his last business as a result of a banking crisis and a trade embargo imposed during the War of 1812. His response to bankruptcy was to leave his very capable and long-suffering wife, Lucy, to raise their two sons, while he joined the crew of a river flatboat and headed into the wilderness to fulfill his dream to paint every bird species in America. He had never lost his interest in the natural world, and he wrote in his journal at this time, "I never for a day gave up listening to the songs of our birds, or watching their peculiar habits, or delineating them in the best way that I could." To the world's immeasurable benefit, his raison d'etre, the double elephant folio edition of The Birds of America, consumed Audubon body and soul until its completion in 1838. These plates, engraved largely by Robert Havell Jr. of London from Audubon's original watercolors and hand-colored by artisans under the artist's direction, comprise 497 bird forms. Many of Audubon's species have been lumped, see lumping, in most cases painted life-size. They also contain a wealth of carefully rendered plants, especially those by the teenaged Joseph Mason, as well as insects and other life forms by Maria Bachmann, and a fine series of period landscapes and townscapes. As was common practice at the time, The Birds of America was sold by subscription and published serially. Thus, while between 175 and 200 complete bound sets of the 27 by 40 inch double elephant folio edition are thought to have once existed, an unknown number of incomplete sets were also published. Many of the complete sets have since been broken up, and the individual leaves sold for increasingly impressive sums. The original subscribers paid $1,000 for the four huge volumes containing 435 plates, a grand enough sum in the 1830s. However, today, a single plate can command as much as $200,000, and a complete elephant folio sold at auction for $10.27 million in 2010, and another for $9.65 million in 2018, up from $440,000 in the early 1980s. After completing The Birds of America, which brought its creator fame and a measure of financial security, Audubon embarked in 1859 on a smaller octavo edition in collaboration with the Philadelphia lithographer J.T. Bowen and a full-sized chromolithograph edition by Julius Bean, which, due to the advent of the Civil War and unscrupulous business practices, was never completed. Also begun right after the publication of the Elephant Folio was Audubon's collaboration with his friend, the Reverend John Bachmann, on the viviparous quadrupeds of North America. But the master's eyesight and energy were beginning to fail, and many of the paintings for this work were done by his son, John Woodhouse Audubon. He grew senile in the last 2 years of his life and died at Minnie's Land, his home overlooking the Hudson in Upper Manhattan. Though Audubon represented himself abroad as a colorful frontier character, an American woodsman, acting and dressing the part with long flowing tresses and rustic fur-trimmed attire, he was not the naive, rude, natural genius he sometimes pretended to be. He had studied in Paris before coming to his father's farm in Pennsylvania at the age of 17, and his shrewdness in promoting himself and his paintings in the highest circles of European society is verified by the publicity he quickly generated and his success at peddling such an expensive work. His wit and sophisticated knowledge of world art traditions, as well as of bird behavior, came through in many of his dramatic compositions and in his writings. Both his ornithological biographies, written with William McGillivray to accompany The Birds of America, and his journals, edited by his granddaughter Maria A. Audubon, contain many passages that are movingly evocative of the early 19th century American wilderness and its inhabitants. Audubon was among the first to lament their sad destruction. Bailey, Florence Merriam, 1863-1948. According to her friends and admirers, the ornithological career of Florence Merriam Bailey owes its great distinction to a combination of personal traits, including a strong affection for the natural world, keen powers of observation, respect for science, and a lucid yet charming writing style. Florence Augusta Merriam was born and spent her childhood at her family's estate on a wooded hilltop at the edge of the Adirondacks. She and her brother, C. Hart Merriam, who also became a distinguished naturalist, were encouraged by both parents to interest themselves in the natural world from an early age. And she benefited from her well-to-do family's connections. Her father corresponded with John Muir after meeting him on a trip to Yosemite, and Ernest Thompson Seton was an early mentor and encouraged her interest in birds. After prep school, she attended Smith College, and though she did not receive a degree, it was during this time that she became an activist in the bird conservation movement. Protests against decorating ladies' hats with wild bird plumes were gathering steam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.